Undr The Cosh. Undr The Cosh. It's Undr The Cosh and Friends. Oh, Undr The Cosh. It's Undr The Cosh. It's Undr The Cosh and Friends. Oh, week by week, we take a peek at another guest, but it's a mystery. Oh, Kylie Minogue, no, Russell Crowe. Oh, more likely a footballer that you don't know. So grab a beer and bring that cheer, cause it's time for Undr The Cosh and Friends.
Johnny boy, Mr. Warrior, how are we getting on?
I'm fucked.
Hey.
Okay, hello. Good, mate.
Are we, what the fuck's happening here? Yeah.
Cheers anyway.
Oh, yeah! The Macho Man Randy Savage! Alright! We okay, boys, huh? We're okay, oh yeah! Elizabeth! Elizabeth! Pass me my drink, Elizabeth! Oh yeah! Oh! We got the finest juice tonight! The cream is rising to the top! The cream is rising to the top. Oh, yeah.
You're right, lads.
We've not done quite that much research, have we?
No.
Jesus Christ.
Can we start again? Fuck me.
Oh, yeah. What are we doing?
Lads, unbelievable effort.
I know, mate. I don't know why they had this task all this time up, because it's getting on my tits already. I've only on 5 minutes.
You look absolutely fantastic.
I'm delighted with his effort.
Makeup was hard work on my own.
I can imagine.
I've gone for primary and secondary colours. You can
see. You must have run out of makeup because you couldn't get red to end of your fucking bugle, couldn't you?
Taking me back, this. I'm going to be twirling all night. Taking me back.
Are we going to explain why we've got this? Why we've come as wrestlers?
Well, I mean, you say that, but I'm pretty sure we decided we were going to be wrestlers before guests were confirmed, didn't we?
Yes, we did.
It just so happens that we've managed to get a wrestler on as well.
Not just any old wrestler,
hero, isn't he?
Preston's finest.
You're like a dog with two dicks, aren't you, Chris?
Oh, I mean, he's a bit beyond my era, I'll be honest with you.
Oh, is he?
Yeah, just outside. This is my era. Early days, and
what,
then
the old, yeah.
It's a bit of bushwhackers.
I'll be honest with you, it's mine as well. I wore a, speaking to Matty before, he's missed out on this.
Yeah, he doesn't know any of us were, does he?
The golden era of wrestling, this is right up there, this.
Who's your favourite ever?
Doink the Clown. Midget.
I don't know if I could... I used to like Paul Bearer in a strange sort of way.
Did you now?
I know you weren't a wrestler, but I just used to like Paul Bearer. Fuck knows why.
Well, we've got some good guests lined up.
People are wondering why I keep adjusting.
I tell you what, you're looking.
it's digging into me hip.
So you let him loose.
That could be us kicked off YouTube, lads.
Nudity.
Yeah, nudity. Obscenities.
Who have we got lined up today? It's not a mystery this week.
No, it's not. What, Lee Trundle?
Lee Trundle.
We've got a guest coming on, a listener coming on first, haven't we?
Listener coming on first. We got Paul Chuckle.
Of course we do.
Fantastic. Thanks everybody who watched for tweeting.
What a fella, by the way. He's been unbelievable on the DMs.
Oh, aye.
Couldn't wait to get on.
I think we've got to give everybody a wrestling introduction.
What do you mean?
Like they're coming down to the ring.
Right, well, I'll tell you what, you do that then, yeah?
Me and Johnny will go to the bar.
If you can hear out, look, it's like a little tune coming on. I'm trying to get my sound louder. and I keep pressing test. So folk knows.
Paul Dickov
coming on. Your old manager, Chrissy.
Yeah, what a fella.
And then the big man, Stu Bennett.
His name weren't Stu in wrestling, though, were it?
No.
Weird
Barrett. Weird Barrett, Hollywood star now.
Yeah.
Is he in films, isn't he?
Oh, yeah. We'll talk about it later, but he's doing one with Vinnie Jones at the minute, so that'll be interesting.
Are they your quiz glasses, Chrissy?
No, I keep these specially for wrestling, lads.
Right.
I keep these specially for wrestling events.
There's a minute, I've pressed something, I've muted myself. Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Thumbs up if you can hear me. Right, I can't hear you yet, lads. There's a minute. What pressed here?
Why have you pressed anything?
An hour and a half.
Give him a ring, Matty. Talk him through.
No. Give us a minute, lads. Give us a minute.
Thanks everybody who's been donating as well, because they've kept rolling in. The bar's going along the bottom. All the money's going NHS, as always. We're just continuing Johnny's fundraising from shaving his head. So we might while we're all here, we might as well keep it going, aren't we?
Be back in a minute, lads.
Take your time.
And thanks everybody who took part in the quiz on Saturday.
Yeah, we need to scrap the picture round on the head, don't we? Knock it on the head.
Yeah, a few people say we're going too slow. Or it's going too slow and then you've not got enough time to answer by the time. So we're learning all the time, aren't we? GTE. My dad always used to say, graduate through experience.
Been running?
I have today. I've not been running every day because I've been grafting. Turning the garage into an office.
I've seen it.
It's first time I've done any proper graft in a while.
What's the insulation like?
50 mil. Itchy, scratchy. Give him a ring, Matthew. Help him out. The man's...
No gravy boat tonight, Chrissy.
Have you started early?
No. Second one, that. Gordon's tonight. Not the best.
I was lagging a bit earlier, and for the first time in about 18 months, I've had an energy drink. So I'll probably be on the ceiling by half time.
Yeah.
But I've got myself a nice sweet cider.
I definitely didn't have you down as a cider, man.
Mm. Sun's out. Which guest are you looking forward to most, Chris?
Dickov.
Right, same as systems.
Have you spoke to him? Have you seen him?
There we go! Hey!
I nearly fell off my chair then.
We're back in the motherfucking room, lads. We're back in the motherfucking room.
Woo! Oh, yeah! John, can you hear us? Can you hear us, John?
I can hear you now. I can hear you.
What did you press?
No more, as if we set it up, innit?
Yeah, because we did.
We did. Fuck knows, mate. I'm just trying to get you all louder. Fuck knows.
Hi, Dickov. Who are you looking forward to, Johnny?
Pardon?
Who are you looking forward to speaking to?
Well, Chuckle, Mr. Chuckle.
Is that how you're addressing him?
Yeah, because he's an institution of mine, mate. That's what I used to watch every day for 10, 15, 10, well, 10 years minimum.
Brilliant. Growing up, he was a vital part of my childhood.
A cog.
Oh, I think he was a big part of everybody's.
Yeah. Of our age, because Martin hadn't heard of him either.
He's more Dick and Dom, isn't he, in the bungalow.
Yeah.
He'll be an Anton Depp fan. Do you know how long you were going, Chuckle Vision? 292 episodes. They did? Yeah.
22 years. Just let me check my research. 22 years they were at it. It's a long old time, that, you know.
21 series. They must have had a year off.
To keep funny. It never. I don't know if it was because I was young, but I never got bored of it. And it was the same gags every week.
A bit like this fucking podcast, to be honest.
Like this isn't you.
Hey, you team up, I'll fucking put him in the back of the net.
Where are you going now?
She's left door open, ain't she? Dom will be down.
You're not leaving any much to the imagination down there, John.
You got the heating off, Johnny?
I tell you what, it's probably 2 inches off being perfect size. It's a little bit too far up my crotch, and I've not quite got enough to wear it at the front. Tell you what, it's not the comfy. I don't know where I'm.
Well, I'll get bored back in.
By the way, as well, the lad that donated £50 on Saturday for the quiz.
Yeah.
Obviously, we said it could come on.
Yeah.
He's gone AWOL.
Shit, AWOL? Bed.
Yeah, I spoke to one of his mates on Instagram, and he said he's too scared to come on.
Oh, no way.
What are you doing? So who've we got on?
We've got Mark Wright, Sunderland fan. Can I do his quiz?
Yeah, you can do his quiz.
Mark Wright, Sunderland. I thought, when you said Mark Wright, I was hoping it was going to be the Mark Wright, and then I could have asked him loads of questions about what it's like sleeping next to his wife.
I thought you were about the Liverpool centre half.
No, I'm on about the Towie guy. She's incredible, isn't she? She's perfect, bless her.
Too skinny for you, John.
And I tell you,
John, you've got the Everton questions, haven't you?
Oh shit! Is that what I need to do? Right, I'm just going to mute myself for 20 minutes, lads.
I would not have been surprised at all. I wouldn't have been surprised.
Mr. Believe it or not, we had a meeting earlier. A meeting, obviously, about tonight. And they said, right, you do the Everton questions for Trump's colleague. And I said, right, I'll do them, but I'm just having an hour's kit first. And I nearly forgot, to be honest. I didn't do them until about 6 o'clock, but they're...
By the way, lads, £50 donation just gone in.
Oh, unbelievable. Lovely. Who's that from? Do we know?
Tremendous. I don't know. The thing is just flashed up.
Whoever it is, thank you very much. We'll find out who it is.
Thanks very much.
I tell you,
that's again, Johnny, yeah?
The ball's out.
Yes.
Kid, no, nothing to eat our tea on for the last two nights.
What did
that? Enter it up floor again.
I know we're a shambles, right? But you could have given it a lick of paint. Honestly.
Let me tell you, I said I'd put a lick of paint on this and everybody said, no, the shitter the better. That's the way we roll.
What? Who's at the top?
At the top? Kirk.
Andy.
Sorry.
At the bottom, I'll just give it a bit of a tilt down there. I don't know if you can see it from that far out, but Matt Kilgallen and Robbie Blake both on two. We have got questions. We have got, I mean, do you want to do yours, Johnny?
Yeah, if you want.
Have you got the balance of questions, Chris?
No.
I have.
Matty.
I've got them here.
Am I playing the quiz?
Yeah.
I think we should all. 3 minutes.
We've all got to get on the board.
Right, no bother.
So give me a second. Every day we have an improvement.
Tash, I'll be honest with you.
Every week we have an improvement, and this week we've got, hold with it, we've got an on-screen timer, everyone. Ooh.
Never rest on your laurels, do you? Rest on your laurels.
Are you ready? Same again. Easy questions. You're a big Barnsley fan. Yeah. Mr. Barnsley, you call yourself, behind closed doors. We know.
Mr. Barnsley, fuck off. Go on.
Are you ready? A minute on the clock. Yeah. As many Barnsley questions as you can get in. Here we go.
Yeah.
What's the name of the stadium?
Oakwell.
Who is the current manager?
Pass.
What's the current league position?
23rd.
24th. Who is the club's mascot?
Toby Tyke.
No, Amos the Donkey.
It's not.
Who's the top goal scorer this season?
Oh, Colin Woodrow.
Correct. Who was number two this season?
What do you mean number two?
Who was number two on the shirt?
Oh, where's number two?
20 seconds, no, John. No.
Gone, no.
What's the capacity of Oakwell to the nearest 1,000?
24.
23. Who beat Barnsley 5-1 this season?
Fucking hell, plenty. Preston, because I went
correct.
To the game.
True or false, Barnsley have won the FA Cup?
Yeah, 1912. Titanic
correct. There we go. Well in. 1, 2, 5. Three, four, five.
No, go on then. What were we five?
Oakwell.
Yeah.
Top scorer this season.
Toby Tyke is the mascot of Barnsley.
Well, I'm sorry, but it says Amos the Donkey here. Oh, no, that John Parkin the Donkey. No, yeah, it says Amos the Donkey.
No, right. 100%.
I mean, I'm pretty sure it's Toby Tyke as well, but that's not what the question sheet says.
Well, give him six. It makes no difference for now. Give him six, Chrissy.
I'll give him six.
Who's the manager at minute?
Manager at the minute is...
German guy.
Gerhard Struber.
No, yeah. And who's number two?
Bloody hell, John. I keep putting paper on the floor.
Why don't you hold it in your fucking hand then?
Number two is Jordan Williams.
No.
No?
If you're watching, Jordan, mate, I'm really sorry. Speaking of Williams, did I tell you about what messaged me last week?
What did he get? Chris?
Nine.
No, I'll give him six.
Nah, 24,000. I got it was 23, so I got that one.
Yeah, I counted them, John.
You got six. I haven't got printouts for us because that was a bit off the cuff. So six.
I've just seen a screenshot of like somebody's took a picture of the thingy, and we look absolutely horrific.
Ridiculous. You're below Shedwick on nine. We're a post-it note. I'll replace it for next week. Don't worry.
All right, so I'm just a token gesture post-it. I'm even getting froth in me, Tash.
Just had word through that the £50 has come from our next guest, Mark Williams.
No way.
Sorry, Mark Wright. Is it?
You're thinking about Mark Williams again.
You didn't have to pay to come on.
So what a fella. What a fella.
Tremendous. So he's just donated it then?
Apparently so. That's the way I'm getting through. That's what I've heard through the grapevine.
I need another task. I need to carry this fundraiser. I mean, my hair started going back now.
He's in the green room as we speak. So should we get him in?
Should we get him in?
Yeah, get him in.
Oh, yeah. Mr. Mark Williams, how are we doing? Mark Wright, how are we doing?
He's not connected yet.
Hi, lads, how are we doing?
Hello, mate.
How are you? What are we on? What are we drinking?
I'm on the Brooklyn Lager.
Oof, nice tipple. Nice
job. It doesn't sound the best.
If things are that tight, mate, you shouldn't have put that donation in. You should have got a nice drink.
Fair play, mate.
I've
about my name as well.
Sorry, mate.
I get it all the time.
Thanks for coming on anyway, Steve.
Sunderland fan.
Yes, indeed. I live in Newcastle, like, but...
season ticket?
No. I work away quite a bit, so I get there a lot more, the away games than the home games.
Would you have seen... night out, innit?
Aye.
Newcastle.
Better.
What were your thoughts on Chris Brown as a footballer for Sunderland?
Be very careful, Mark.
Do you know what? That goal against Derby, I would say, is probably like one of the turning points of the when Sunderland turned the corner, when Roy Keane took over. So that goal, I remember that. I don't know how many other goals he scored. Like, I remember that one.
First goal of Keane's era, that.
It was, aye.
If you only score three goals, you're going to fucking remember one, aren't you? Hmm.
I think you got a few more than that, didn't you?
9, 10, I think.
9, 10. How many, Chris?
9 or 10.
Devon.
I think they tried to take one off us for summer.
Devon.
Came off my bugle, and they didn't give us it. But I'm counting it.
Surprised you didn't fucking bust the ball with that. Never mind fucking score with it.
How much money did you make out of the carol singing, by the way?
Honestly, mate, there was three of us. We used to do 100 quid a night and split it between three of us.
Money.
Honestly, it was
Are you thinking about it?
I'll tell you what, at the moment, you never know the way things are going at the moment.
Standard end at drive.
Thing is, we were full-time at Sunderland as well. And I was earning nearly half me. We were on like 70 quid or something a week. I was earning half my money in one night. So we make.
I say we're full-time carol singers. The amount of full-time at Sunderland.
We make a weekend of it. Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Job done.
You might have made on goal bonuses.
What?
Goal bonuses.
Nah, I was in the youth team, man. So I wasn't. I was all right back then. I think.
You didn't score much in that fucking year, that youth team.
Shut up.
Give us a tune, Chris.
A what?
Give us a tune. Your favourite carol.
What were your go-to carol?
What
was the one for the big tip? There must have been one.
There was once. She listened to the whole performance and she went away for like 2 minutes or something. We thought we were in the money. And she's come back with a packet of biscuits, right? And so, brilliant, lads, brilliant. So, like, kind of taken them. And I got the end of the drive and I checked the sell-by date and they're out of date.
What were they?
I took them back and complained. God's honest truth.
No, we believe you. Mate, you were 17. You were old enough to go and have an argument with somebody, weren't you?
I know.
Are you a big fan of the podcast then, Matt?
I do listen to it. I travel a lot with work, so I listen a lot when I'm driving about. So,
what do you do, Matt?
You what?
What do you do? What's your job?
I'm a software consultant, so...
Oh, can you go round to Johnny's house?
We need you fucking 6 weeks ago.
So travel about a bit. So I've normally like long distance driving or up planes and stuff. So I've usually listened to podcasts and stuff. So decent.
What's been your favourite?
Do you know what the Matt Pike one was decent that you just had? All the ex-Sunderland ones, I would say. But as much as a pain as to say, the John Beresford one, I really, really enjoyed that one.
Yeah.
Really good.
Because you weren't there, were you, Chrissy?
No.
It was just me and John, but he made it so easy for us, didn't he?
Mate, he's a great lad, Bez. I mean, I go out with him once every 6 weeks or whatever on a Monday, and he's a great... He's just full of life, all. He's just a great lad.
Yeah.
So easy to talk to, like.
You thought about getting Kevin Ball on or anyone like that?
We're hoping to get him on for the live show. If it's still... I think it's in September, the Sunderland one, so...
No, it's not.
Comes on for that, it'll be then released as a podcast.
July, August, isn't it?
It's one of them. Are you coming or?
I haven't. Well, there's loads up here, isn't there? There's one in Bishop Auckland. I'm originally from that way on, so might get to that one if that was still going on. But is there one over Newcastle or not? Because I live over here.
No, I don't think we've booked one there.
No. But I tell you what, for that donation, we'll sort you a couple of tickets, mate. 100%.
Yeah. Oh, I'll get myself along when all things are all better.
Yeah. Well, hoping that we don't have to rearrange.
Right.
If we do have to rearrange, you'll still have to win some pickets anyway. No problem at all, mate.
No worries. Champion.
So no problem at all.
Are you fancying yourself on this Sunderland quiz, Mark?
I'll give it a go. Like, to be honest, like I'm not that great at Sunderland. Depends how general knowledge there are.
No, can it's all Sunderland. Yeah. You got to get it from Chrissy himself. Now I'll tell you, Jack Dicker, who come on last week, got 9.
Out of how many? 10.
Well, it's a minute. It's a minute.
All right, up there.
So you've got 9 to beat, and if you want to beat Kirk, Andy Wehrman, you've got 10.
Right.
To go top of the table.
Okay.
So if you don't know it, just pass it on.
That's right.
Are you ready, mate? 3.
I am.
2-1. Here we go.
What year did Sunderland win the FA Cup?
FA Cup 1973-37.
Yeah. Who scored the winning goal?
In Portfield.
Yeah. To the nearest 1,000, what is the capacity of the stadium alight?
49,000.
Yeah. Why did they replace the seats in the ground at the beginning of the 18-19 season?
Because they were pink.
Yeah. Player to command the biggest transfer fee when leaving SAFC?
Pickford.
Yeah. Which former player went on to lift the Champions League as a captain?
Henderson.
Name the old stadium?
Roker Park.
Sunderland's highest ever Premier League finish?
7th.
The TV documentary following Peter Reid and his squad was called what?
Premier Passions.
Who was manager before Jack Ross?
Chris Coleman.
Yeah. Who was the current chairman?
Stu Donald.
Yeah. Darren Bent left Sunderland to join which club?
Villa. You run out of questions?
Give him a.
Go on.
He started to finish. Go on. Go on, Chris. Give him the last question.
Club record appearance maker.
Jimmy Montgomery.
Yes.
Oh, my word. Right. How many is that?
It was 12, but you said, Mark said an answer. And you never said what if it were right or not.
Yeah, they were all right. If I moved on, they were right.
I didn't realise I knew that much about them, to be fair.
13.
So how many questions, Chris?
13.
13?
Yeah.
You got 13 out of 13.
Yeah.
You don't want to be on this show, mate.
Tell you what, mate, if only there were a prize, eh? Unfortunately, you're just at the top of a piece of ply.
Tell you what a place to be.
What a place to be. 13.
It just cost you £50 for everybody to realise that you know loads about Sunderland.
I know. Chuckle Brothers will probably... Paul Chuckle will probably get higher than this.
Hello.
13.
I thought you said you weren't sure how much you knew.
Well, to be fair, they're quite easy, like, fair, so obvious stuff, like, if you were just how many goals you've scored, I wouldn't have known that.
He don't know.
I can imagine it weren't bugging many. It's too easy, Chris, sorry. Too easy.
I missed it. You're lucky.
The quiz last week was hard, man, I must say that. On Saturday.
Who did Saturdays?
Especially when the wrong answers become right and vice versa.
the answers weren't wrong. Venezuela is the oil capital of the world.
It was the footy one. Was it Chelsea Manu or something? Chelsea.
Yeah. Why did that go wrong?
That was my fault.
Say what you've started, Mark.
Ah, sorry, lads.
That was my fault. Listen.
Right, mate.
Hold my hands up.
Well, cheers, guys. Have a great night.
Well done.
Cheers, Mark. Thanks for the donation. Thanks for taking part.
There's
a great chance you've won the quiz. You just won the quiz. Full stop.
We'll see.
We'll send you this piece. We'll send you this ply. That's it's in the post.
Cheers, lads.
How can you say I don't know that much about it and then get 13 questions right in fucking 60 seconds?
I thought he was going to get them all. Because I had to press C more. That's why I thought I came to the end.
Lee Trundle's ready, lads.
I keep fidgeting with this task, right? It's either going to drop off or it's just getting wet with ale. So
Have you played with Lee? Played against Lee?
I've played against Shuns quite a few times, and I'll say it when he comes on, because it don't do him justice.
Well, let's get him on. Our second guest of the evening. Here he is. He's been called the King of Swansea City with 83 goals in 163 league appearances. The very first professional footballer outside the Premier League to sign image rights with a mullet that even Paul Chuckle would be proud of. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, please welcome to the ring, Lee Trundle.
How you doing, guys?
Hello, mate.
Yeah, good, thanks. You're okay?
Yeah.
Yes, Hulk's there.
Oh, yeah.
Well in, boys.
How are you getting on?
Never got the message about the fans' address then, Trundle?
No, I would have got in. I would have, who would have I? Ric Flair, I would have been.
Woo!
Hell of a choice.
You're just saying then, right? When you were doing his introduction then, yeah, as a player, I would say, without blowing smoke up your ass, probably the most skillful player I think I've ever played against.
No, nice one, Park. I had to be me because I couldn't run, could I? So I had to keep the ball somewhere.
But I couldn't run and I weren't fucking skillful, so I don't know what we...
You were a beast, though, when the ball come into you. That's it, it's sticking, isn't it? You were an handful, mate.
Still playing, aren't you?
Yeah, I'm playing in the Welsh League for Ammanford, so I still enjoy it. I still love match day. I still love getting out there, so...
I play
for them on a Saturday. I'll be 44 in October.
How's the body?
I've got 12 goals in 14 games here this season. Is that right?
Yeah, that's the way, isn't it? Yeah, I'm feeling all right. Don't get me wrong. I don't do loads of running in games, you know what I mean? I'll stay central. I've got young lads around me that have got legs, so I'm still enjoying it, still scoring. I think I've scored 13 in 14 games, so you know, I'm enjoying it.
Tremendous, man. I can't remember you signing for Preston. Obviously, you know, record at Swansea's unbelievable. I just can't remember you going to Preston. What happened there?
Well, I'd been out to the... When I left Swansea, I went to sign for Neath in the League of Wales. They were just... Dad's an owner that I took over them, who was throwing a bit of money at it and wanted to get them into Europe. So I had two seasons there. And then the club collapsed. They went defaulted. So then I ended up, you know, looking for another club. And then I managed to get Preston interested and went up to speak to Preston. But I'd done me ACL and cartilage in pre-season, so never played. I made one FA Cup appearance as a sub, but never played with me knee.
Who was manager?
Wesley.
Neath to Preston, some move. That's like... That's outrageous, really, isn't it?
Lee Fowler-esque.
Yeah, well, that's what I mean, because when I went into the League of Wales, I thought that was me, you know, that was me last. Then I'd finished from professional football. And went and played there. I signed a 3-year contract at the club, and I thought that would do me, and then I'll take it from there then. But then obviously that was cut short, and you know, the move to Preston come up, which was brilliant for me, because you know what a club Preston is.
How did
it's
you get
a
on
fantastic
with it?
Club, but it didn't have a fantastic manager at the time, did it?
Do you know what? He was mad in what he'd done. Do you know, I understand how he'd done stuff, but like from a football point of view, if you played at different clubs, you know, it's probably, well, it's hard to take to get into the regime of doing it. You know, you'll come in at 10 every morning and you'll leave at 4 and you wouldn't have a day off. You'd be right the way through. And I went up to sign. I went up to meet him. So then I'm sitting in his office. I'm with the captains in there as well. Moose sitting, so it's them two behind the table and me on this side. So he goes to me, are you still keeping fit? I said, yeah, still train every day. He said, what's your body fat? And I went, oh, I'm not sure. So he goes, take your top off. So I'm in the office, whip the top off. So I'm standing there tensing up in the office. So he goes to me, well, about 12%. I went, oh, yeah, I'll take that. So we sat down. So he started talking about how he does stuff differently at the football club and what they do. And he says, have you ever done animal yoga? I said, no, I've never heard of it. And he went, so lie on the floor. So here's me in the office, lying on his floor, them two are behind the desk. So he goes, now close your eyes. Now just relax. So I'm lying on the floor, my eyes closed. He's going, now you can hear the wind. You can hear the river flowing. So I'm lying there and he says, now you're an elephant. So I'm here. I'm after a contact, aren't I? So the arm goes up as the like this with the arm up. So he starts, he's carry on talking to me, and then he goes, "Now you're gonna sing like an elephant." So then I've got up and said, "Ah, you're taking the piss now." And him and Moose have started laughing from behind the desk. But then I seen a thing with Moose, what he done, and he said he does it to test players. He wants to see if you're with him and you're buying into it. He said, but if I would have lied on the floor or started singing like an animal or done everything what he wanted me to, he wouldn't have had me. He wants to see a little bit of fight back. And, you know, crazy to go into a first meeting and that's what you end up doing. I think what's that, Park?
You're not even signing. You're giving it the old...
Yeah, that's amazing. But and because he told me to bring kit with me as well. Must have wanted to do some running, me and the captain. But like after that, all that had happened, he said, "Oh, it's all right. It doesn't matter." So at least I got out to a bit of running anyway.
it's a different animal, isn't it?
He strikes me as somebody that whatever he does is just for a test.
That is exactly what he does, and he wants to push people and see how far he can go and when they're going to bite back. And in a way, I understand what he does and the way he wants to do things. But I think if you've been at a lot of football clubs through your career and you've had a certain way of training, once you come into that, like to me at the end, you know, some of the things was strange. Like I done my ACL and my cartilage, but the Friday before the Saturday game, we was out on the training pitch with an army coach carrying each other on our shoulders, carrying jerry cans with full of water, carrying each other on stretcher, army crawls for the full pitch. We were out there for like 3.5 hours. If you've done something wrong, you get 15 minutes added on. So we were out there for 3.5 hours and then I had to go and play a game the next day. And how it went, I've got a tackle. Me and the player have went down and I've just went to jump up, legs crossed. And as soon as I jumped up, I just heard it crack then. And then I knew that was it. But I think if I might have done, don't get me wrong, it might have happened in the season, but to do 3.5 hours training on a Friday at my age, which I was 35, then going to a game, you know, I think that's definitely affected me.
Yeah. How old were you then?
35.
So, but then you can say that, but you've recovered at 35 and you're still playing 8 years later, is it?
Yeah, but when I come back from that, you know, the everyday training, That's what was getting me. I was just getting niggle after niggle. And now, obviously, you know, my training is tailored a completely different way where I'm not training at that intensity. I think if I had to do that and play a game, you know, I don't think I'd be able to get through it, if I'm honest.
Yeah. It's just a totally, totally different entity. I mean, when it came into Newport, I was 35. And within about 30 minutes, I thought, this is not for me, this.
Do you know what, Park? Yes, you remember Liam, the sports strength and conditioning coach who was at Newport? Do you remember him?
Yeah.
Liam Carpenter. Well, he was talking because he trained in the gym where I train in Swansea. And he was telling me about it. You've just reminded me now. And he was saying, but it's like, same with me. He wanted me to do these runs, like box-to-box ones. And you had to be in within a certain time. Now, when I was 27, I wouldn't have got in that time. It's just not my type of running.
Yeah, exactly.
But he'll judge off that and say, well, if you can't do that, you can't play on Saturday. And, you know, that's not the case.
I was Kenny Jackett for you when you were at Swansea.
Yeah, do you know, I found Kenny all right. You know, he come in and he changed it. You know, beforehand, we had a bit of a drinking culture at the club and we were out a fair bit. And if we're honest, probably let Brian Flynn down a little bit, but we had like 11 of us away from home for the first time.
Who's in that little squad?
So me, Leon Britton, Andy Robinson, Brad Maley, Brian Murphy, then Gary Monk come. So we had we were all away from home for the first time. So we were going out a lot. And then Kenny come in as manager. So Kenny then got us all on a one-on-one meeting. So he's brought me into the office and he said to me, I've heard you like a night out, don't you? And I said, yeah, I don't mind one. And he said, so when do you go out? And I said, well, I'll go out a Saturday, a Sunday, and a Wednesday. And he went, well, don't you think that's a bit much for a professional footballer? And I said, well, not really, because I used to go out on a Monday, but I've not had on the head now. But that's me I'm sitting there, I look back now and I think, he must have been sitting there thinking, what's going on now? But me in my head, I'm thinking, what's wrong with him? We're doing all right. Yeah. But,
I'm doing him a favour by dropping in a fucking Monday.
Well, that's what I was thinking, Park. That's what I was saying. But, he turned it around and he did, to be fair to him, we didn't go out as much and turned it around and ended up getting a promotion under Kenny. But Kenny was one of them managers where he knew what he needed to get out of that bottom division and, he'd done really well doing it.
I mean, it's a strange place. When I went Cardiff, it's a strange place, Wales. It's as though you're just in a different world, isn't it?
Yeah, but I think if you look at Cardiff is a bigger city than Swansea as well, Park. So, there's a lot more to do there. Swansea has got its lovely areas, but the way the fans are, they're just so passionate and the hostile, aren't they? Especially you playing for Cardiff, you'd know how they talk about Swansea and vice versa. You hate each other.
Are you still involved now, Truns?
Yeah, I'm club ambassador. So a lot of my stuff will be out and about in the community. Or when the club need representing, that's something I'll go along to that. And on a match day when Swans are at home, I then host one of the lounges, so I'm still involved with the club.
Yeah,
you've had some strike partners over the years, some big characters there as well. I keep finding.
That's the thing at Swansea. It was loads of different characters, big characters, and I think at the time we had. We were in League One, and we had myself, Bayo, Knighty, and Rory Fallon. Four good strikers for
Leon
for that,
Knight
for that level, and
friend of the show, Leon Knight.
Yeah, Leon Knight. Yeah, friend of the show. Well, same again. Knighty, good player, mate. If you get him in that boxing and around the goal, whenever he gets his chance, he puts them away.
It was just a fucking. It must have been a fucking nightmare, man. I mean,
a lot of people from side, see the way he is on Twitter and the way he's controversial and everything. When he was in with the lads, he'd have the odd argument, but we all would. But he was never disruptive in the squad. I've heard stories about before where he's had arguments with managers and stuff. But at Swansea, when he left, it was like it was a surprise to everyone because he just wasn't there one day at training, and he said that they got rid of him. But football wise, he was there. He'd scored like. I think he scored like something like 14 in 16 or something mad like that, and then we turn off the training and get told that he wasn't there.
He blamed
big argument with Susan, apparently. Kit Lady had a big argument with Susan.
Oh yeah, I've seen other ones, and I've seen where he's blamed there. I've seen him saying stuff like that. But people ask me, but I honestly don't know what happened.
Do you get on with Susan?
If you look at it, what's that?
Do you get on with Susan?
Yeah, I do. Yeah, she sounds Susan. She's been there for years. I get on really well with her. Her son's in there as kit man as well now, and he's a good lad.
Mate, when they were talking about her, I can remember because she's always in tunnel, weren't she? And when he said blonde-haired woman who was in tunnel, I thought, I know exactly who he's on about.
Yeah, because she's a lively character. She'd chat to everyone. She'd be speaking and that. And so, because I think it was on your... Was it on your podcast where we were speaking about it?
Yeah. Not nice either.
Yeah, well, I seen clips of it.
Yeah, it did go down well. You're an Everton fan, aren't you, right?
Yeah, Everton, yeah.
Johnny's got a bit of a quiz for you. 60 seconds on the clock. Are you fancying yourself?
Not the best on quizzes, but I'll have a go.
They're easy enough.
Hey, I'm not the best on fucking writing quizzes, neither. This could be anything. Right, well, you're going to have to do stop clock because...
I'm on the stop clock.
Right. So don't tell you me worry. When to go. Give me a counting.
3, 2, 1, go.
Who was the Everton permanent manager before Ancelotti?
You've not started well, I'll be honest.
Silver.
You can pass.
No, I've said him, Silver.
Silver, correct.
Yes. Who's Everton's all-time leading goal scorer?
Dixie Dean.
Correct. Who are Everton's main kit sponsor this season?
Umbro.
Sport Pesa. We're on about the thingy one. Anyway, who is Everton's captain this season?
So no. Pass.
Pass, because I've done fucking 15 questions.
Go on, pass.
What type of animal is Chang, the Everton mascot?
An elephant.
Correct. What was the last trophy Everton won?
FA Cup.
What year was it?
1995.
We'll give you that one. Six. There we go. Time up.
Ball ride out.
Love it, mate. You're just getting going as well.
I know. Just getting your pace then.
That's the every. It was the modern questions that I wasn't good on. All the back ones, I was all right.
As soon as you got elephant and it took you back to that office, you're away.
That's it. An elephant never forgets.
I hope we get another Everton fan on because I've got another fucking seven questions to ask.
Runs, before you go, what's your favourite goal for Swansea?
It'd have to be in there. Well, it's the Johnson's Paint Trophy. It was in the Millennium Stadium against Carlisle. That probably goes down as my favourite one. Leon Britton crossed it, chest and then volley into the far corner.
I'm going to get it on YouTube as we speak.
I'll tell you what, he must have been some player, by the way, Brits. I mean, obviously we played against him quite a few times, but you know, for how small they were.
Yeah. Do you know what? It sounds stupid, but the higher he went, the better he got. I think when Kenny Jaffett was there, Kenny never played him, or he'd play him out wide. He played Owen Tudor Jones and Chris O'Leary in the midfield. He never played Leon, but you know, the more Leon climbed, you know, watching him on the pitch, never give the ball away, his positional sense, he was brilliant.
It's mad, isn't it? Like the lad, there's a lot of lads who went from League Two to the Premier League. Tate, he was one.
Yeah.
Leon Britton.
Yeah, so, Monk was another. So the but if you probably looked at Brits in League Two and said, can he make the jump to the Premiership? I don't know, Premier League clubs would have took him. But when he's climbed up the leagues and then they've seen him with Swansea, you know, he was one of our best players throughout his career there.
Yeah. You know, just a quick one for you on Tatey, mate. I used to have a bit of beef with Tatey. And I can remember we're in League Two, right?
You do like a bit of beef with Tatey, don't you? Every Sunday.
And I'm having a bit of beef with Tatey, right? And his fucking Champions League medal me off in League Two away at Moss Rose playing against fucking Macclesfield. I said, you can get fucked off, you.
Tatey was one of them. He would wind everyone up all the time. He'd have an argument or a fight. I don't know whether he needed that to get him going in games, but he would do it every single game.
Thing is, now I know why he hasn't come on. I asked him to come on, and he made some excuse about working at Swansea, but now I know he hates you.
We're six. You're sandwiched between Michael Vaughan and John Parkin, which...
No, you know, I'll take that.
It's not a bad place to be.
Not a bad place to be. I know which way I'd be facing.
Right, mate, thanks very much for coming on.
Yeah, it's up, man.
My pleasure, boys. Enjoy
all the best to the family. Hope you're looking after yourself.
Lads.
Catch you later.
See you later, boys. Thank you.
Cheers, mate.
See you, mate.
Top man.
I don't want to just say it before, but is this going quite smoothly?
The timer's too loud, Chrissy, apparently.
Oh, timer's too loud. To be honest, I didn't realise it was making any noise.
Your answer to your question, John, is no.
So all you're saying to me is the worst thing about tonight is that the timer's too loud.
Yeah. And the 10 minutes when we couldn't hear you. At the beginning.
Yeah, press the wrong button, mate. Give us a break.
Good work on the questions, though, Johnny boy.
Yeah, very good.
Yeah. As I say, I've got another seven or eight to go on Everton, so we need to get another Everton fan on.
I'm a little bit nervous now, lads, I'll be honest with you.
Yeah. Why?
Paul Chuckle, man. Paul Chuckle.
Is Paul on now?
He's up next.
He must be in the waiting room, is he?
I hope so. Paul Chuckle next again. We've had some more donations in, so thanks for that.
Just read the leaderboard out, Chrissy.
Top to bottom, Mark Wright is stormed ahead now. Stormed ahead with 13.
Mark, I can tell you now, Mark Wright is the champion of this.
Kirk, Andy Wehrman in second. Jack Dicker from last week, he's in third with 9. Chris Sedgwick, 9. John Parkin, 6. Lee Trundle, 6. Michael Vaughan, a disappointing 3. And then Matt Kilgallen and Robbie Blake at the bottom with a miserable 2.
I said the thing with Vaughan that got me when he went, how many times have Sheffield Wednesday won the FA Cup? None.
He wasn't having it either. I think he thought you were lying, Chrissy.
No, he weren't. He weren't happy. He weren't happy. So, I tell you what, soon as Mr. Chuckle comes on, because that's what I'm going to refer to him as, I'm going to have the second worst tash on this.
Yeah.
The incredible tash.
Second worst tash? You saying he's second got a bad best. Tash?
Oh. Tash is in there.
Yeah, but it's a good tash. It's a good second tash. Best.
Well, second best. Well, there's only two tashes, so it's worst, isn't it?
There's three.
I read an article with him earlier that his mullet's getting a bit out of control. He said he's had it since the 80s and he's kept it. And he's, for the first time in his life, he's been able to get a ponytail. Interested to see how it's looking.
Yeah, I can't wait for this. This is my childhood. It's like reliving my childhood, this.
Did you watch it, Chris?
Yeah. Oh, to me, to you.
Yeah.
And he's been he DJs now, does events.
I see him. I can't wait to talk to him. That's what I want to talk to him about.
Should we get him in? I believe he's ready.
Let's do it.
Yes, get him in. Right, just give him a minute.
Here we go. Next in the ring, we have a true legend of his game. For many growing up in the 80s, 90s and 2000s, you can forget Max Sennett, you can forget Laurel and Hardy, you can even forget Charlie Chaplin. One of the true kings of slapstick is in the house. He's a comedian, a writer, an actor, a DJ, and cooker of one mean bread and butter pudding. Yes, the one, the only, Paul Elliott, a.k.a. Paul Chuckle. How are we doing?
Cheers, guys, to me, to you. Yeah, you listen.
We've made it, lads.
I'm off to bed. I'm off to bed. That's me. I'm off to bed. That's my life complete.
You didn't say that, did you? Did you say it back? To you.
To me.
To me.
Oh, come on. Life can get any better, lads.
Chris, just rip the script up.
Yeah, we're gone.
We're done.
How was that bread and butter pudding? It looked fantastic on Twitter last night.
It was very, very nice. A little bit sloppy inside, as it would be. You know.
We all like a little bit sloppy inside, don't we?
Oh, yeah, every time. It was really nice, though. Nice and warm, you know what I mean? It was lovely. tasty stuff.
Cream? What did you have it with? Was it custard and cream combo or both?
Cheers, I see you've got one there. Have a get it down the neck.
Oh, yes.
What did you pair the pudding with? Cream and custard?
Custard.
On its own?
Oh, always custard. Beautiful. Oh, yeah. No cream. Sorry, have I upset you now?
I'm a custard and cream man.
Oh, yeah. Well, you're spoilt.
We've been doing these videos, Paul, just, well, to keep us entertained, hopefully a few other people as well. But you're obviously through these times, but you're a survivor. I believe that, unfortunately,
I wasn't well for about 10 days. I was really, really rough. I didn't go in hospital or anything. Didn't even see a doctor. They don't send them out or anything to you anymore. But the wife phoned 111, and she explained how I was, and they got a nurse to ring me back and ask me everything, how I felt and everything. And she said, oh, it definitely sounds like you've got the COVID. 19, whatever it is, just stay in bed and take loads of paracetamols, you know, to keep the temperature down. And if it gets worse or you get trouble with your breathing, phone an ambulance, 999. And that was it. So I did. I was at 38.4 temperature, which is quite high.
Jeez.
Yeah. And it kept coming up and down. It was dropping to just below 38 and then back up to 38.3 and 38.4. It was a horrible feeling. No, I had no appetite. And I tell you what, that tasted awful. Which is
Yeah, Paul, fuck the food, mate. As long as the ale tastes nice, don't worry about the food, does it?
Yeah. I tell you, if anybody's alcoholic, then they want to get COVID-19, they'll be fine. They won't touch it. You do get over it.
Paul, I'll tell you what, like, this is like from my childhood. This is like talking to a hero from my childhood.
Cheers, man. Cheers.
Thanks. Yeah, for all three of us.
Yeah. Good guys. It was a good career.
I mean, I'm still at it. Don't worry. Yeah. I'm on my own now. But...
I had tickets for your tour.
What?
I had tickets for your tour.
My tour?
Yeah, the live tour.
Were you DJing?
Oh. You're DJing tour?
Well, DJing. I'm DJing all over the place, yeah. Well, I was.
I know.
I've got nothing now. All the pubs and clubs are shut. Theatres are shut. They're not filming much on TV. So here we are, sitting watching this. No football, that's the worst.
I know, man.
Hey, what are you doing on a Saturday afternoon?
Just got a drink, haven't we? That's all we can.
Are you still going to the games, Paul?
Is what?
Are you still going to the games when you can?
Oh, aye, when they're on and the games and I'm not working, I'm down there. Because they made me and Barry ambassadors at Rotherham United.
Yeah.
About 12 years ago or more, 14 years ago. So go every week. It's in the director's box and one or two of those and something to eat. And sitting in that couple of seats and watch the match. It's brilliant, brilliant. And we're having a great season as well, we were.
Lion, aren't you?
I saw the video when, obviously, sadly, Barry passed away at the game with all the fans. That must have been a special moment with all the fans singing.
Yeah, the match after, it was the Tractor Boys from Ipswich.
Yeah.
We were playing them. And luckily for Barry, we won 1-0. But on the 73rd minute, because he was 73 when he passed, both ends of the ground were shouting, to you, to me, to you. And loads of applause and everything.
Were the Ipswich fans involved with it as well, were they?
Yeah, they were doing it as well. Both Rotherham were shouting, to you, and the Ipswich fans were going, to me, and they were going to either end of the pitch.
Oh, fantastic.
Really nice, really nice. Choking. It was choking, you know, at the time.
Yeah.
Sometimes we have football, the actual football team didn't matter, does it?
Exactly. You know, like that
moments where it didn't matter who you supported.
Exactly, no, it was really moving, you know, and I tweeted to them, to the Tractor Boys, you know, thanks guys, what a great set of lads you are. Even though they'd lost at the end, they were still
going for it.
Yeah, still texting me and saying that was great, brilliant.
How old were you when you and Barry started and got the TV deal? And
I was 15 when I left school. In those days, you did. Talk about the olden days, of course. I left school at 15. All I wanted to do was play footy. You know, I played for all the school teams, the junior school, senior school. One season, we were completely unbeaten the whole season at Spillhay. And I don't know if you remember a guy called Phil Cliff, played for Sheffield United, and then, man, you're talking about the 1960s, so probably won't.
We're a bit too young for that, Paul. Yeah, we're a bit too young for that.
Yeah, but he was my next-door neighbour, and we grew up together. We did nothing but play football. We had a great football team at school. I was going to that, and at 14, I got an injury playing for Rotherham Boys, and that was it. The career was over. They said, you'll never play again. So I started with Barry, because Barry was already in the business, because Dad was a comic. Mom was a dancer. Our sister was a dancer for a while. And the eldest two brothers were a double act. And Barry was already being a single comic. So what else do I do? I join Barry.
Join the family trade.
You want to five siblings?
Yeah, six.
Six siblings. Bloody, you don't have a telly in your house, your mum and dad.
In those days, they didn't, I tell you. Yeah, I had four brothers. My sister had five. That takes a while to sink in a lot of time.
Not for us from Yorkshire, mate, it done.
No, we're on it. I can't complain at anything. I mean, I've enjoyed every day of my life, except on serious days, obviously, like when Barry passed away and Mum, Dad passed away and Dad passed away and Jimmy passed away and Sheila passed away and Colin passed away. And I lost a daughter at 3 months old back in 1974. But apart from that, I've had a good life.
So you say you're still involved now, Paul. What else are you doing, apart from your tour?
What now? Well, I'm sitting in the garden doing stuff and nothing and doing a few of these podcasts and stuff. There's nothing else to do. I'm doing some telegrams to people. Telegrams, you know.
You're not the queen, Paul.
People can pay like 30 quid and have a message to them or to their brother or their wife or whatever. I'm doing a few of those, which is the only income I've got. If anybody out there has got a few grand to send me to keep me going. I'm not on a footballer's wage, that's the trouble.
Send Paul some money, please. Send Paul.
Please. Just fund me. Just fund me.
Did you ever get in there, you know, the old ground at Millmore? Did you ever get into the volleys back in the day?
I played there, and I tell you, it was knackering. Did you ever play there? It was knackering going, kicking up towards the Tivoli end. There was a 6-foot drop on the pitch. You couldn't really see it unless you really looked, but there was a 6-foot drop. And if you were playing up towards the Tivoli end, it was knackering. Well, look, people are more fit than I am.
There was a 6-foot drop in every ground that I played at, Paul, I'll be honest with you.
What position were you?
Me, I was a winger. So nowadays, I would have been really knackered having to go right back to play full-back and attack. In those days, it was three up front.
Were you piercing?
Left wing and your centre-forward. And, you know, your midfielders were inside right and inside left and right half and left half. It's completely different, really. Although, if you look at it, if you played a 7.3, 2.46 or whatever they're playing nowadays with the game.
Probably Chris was the only one ever said to me, you never give it back to anyone. Breeding, you see. Yeah. You like that one? You like it?
Yeah. Yes. Unprovoked and shy, Paul. That's what it was.
Yeah. What would you say?
Got a quiz. We've got a quiz for you.
All right. Yeah.
Testing your Rotherham knowledge.
Oh, there they are, the boys.
We've gone easy on you. Chris has gone easy on you.
Thank you.
I know you said that you were, but I noticed you were on Celebrity Mastermind and your specialist subject was English football clubs. So I've got high expectations here, Paul.
Thank you. I wasn't that good on it, I tell you.
I wasn't going to mention that. I did watch it to the end.
I was only 3 points off winning it, though.
Oh, so everybody else didn't do very well either.
No. But we were told beforehand that the last lot in that recorded before us, the winner had 4 points. So it gave us a bit of confidence. The winner had 4 points at the end of the game.
Jesus.
You'd have pissed it then, wouldn't you?
I would have done, yeah. I got 10.
If you'd have been 3 hours early, you'd have pissed it.
Yes.
So we've got 60 seconds on the clock, Paul.
Oh, dear.
As many Rotherham questions as we can get in.
Right.
I'm just pulling up the timer. Bear with me 1 second. Here we go. Yeah, go on. You do the timer, Chris. Multitasking.
Well, I'll do the answers.
Right. Look at this. Like a well-oiled machine.
Can you do a bit of that to give me a clue on the answer?
I'll do my best. Are you ready, Chris?
I'm ready, lads.
Are you ready, Paul?
I'm ready.
Here we go. Name Rotherham's stadium.
New York Stadium.
Correct. Who is the current manager?
Warney.
Correct. Who is the club's mascot?
Miller Bear.
Yes. What colour is this season's away kit?
Which one do you want? Light blue, grey?
The white one.
The right
white.
One?
The white one.
White.
It's white. Name, yeah. The name of Rotherham's old stadium?
Millmore.
Yes. Who is the club's chairman?
Tony Stewart.
Who was the manager before Paul Warne?
Oh, pass.
Kenny Central. Jackett. What's the brand on the front of the shirt?
It's a new shirt.
Paul, I want you to win. I want you to win, Paul.
Pass. What is the capacity of the New York Stadium to the nearest 1,000?
12,000.
Correct.
Oh,
what are we doing? What have we done?
Is that time?
That's time.
Seven.
You've beat Michael Vaughan.
Oh, good lad. Well, young lad from Yorkshire.
And you've beat John Parkin.
I want to say 17.
No. Well, you could have made them easier.
Paul Chuckle, there we are. Above Lee.
Around that time before Warney, we had like several that were coming and going all over the place because, you know, we were not doing well.
Warnock was there, wasn't he, for a spell?
Yeah, Neil, and I asked him if he'd stay in the next season at the awards ceremony. And he said, no, I'm going to retire. Next thing we know, he's at Cardiff.
Yeah. I mean, he must have been 68, 69 when he came to Rotherham and kept him up, weren't he?
Exactly. What a job he did there. What a job he did. We were full bottom. And he, I think, the last 11 games unbeaten from nowhere. You know.
What would you say was the pinnacle moment of your career, Paul?
Was there a moment? Getting the BAFTA. We got a BAFTA.
Yeah.
If I tilt that up.
Oh, there it is.
At the back there.
Yeah. So, yeah.
Elf in the middle at the top. There, just there, look, there it is.
Perfect.
That's very well.
If I were you, mate, if I were you, I'd have had it on my shoulder. Not there.
No, it was that was a great thing. It was being patted on the back by your peers. You know, peers, it's like scoring the goal, and the lads all jump all over you. It's a nice feeling. Doing the Royal Variety performance, doing the Children's Royal Variety back in the 90s, and having our own TV series all those years. So there's lots of them.
Some years as well.
Yeah. I do miss our kid, though. It's obviously, we had so much fun on stage. You know, as filming on Chuckle Vision, we never stopped laughing. And on stage, I could make him laugh at a drop of a pin, and he could make me...
Did you ever have any arguments, Paul, where you were like... You know, like, brotherly argument, he's like, fuck off,
you can't say that, John.
Have arguments, don't they?
Even when we were kids, yeah, we would, you know. Being brothers, within 5 minutes, you'd forgotten, and as kids, you were playing again together, you know, 5 minutes later.
Did you ever do stuff off script, just impromptu, you know, your lines and stuff when you were going?
Most of it was. Even on Chuckle Vision, we'd put stuff in all the time. We'd just add something. I mean, to me, to you, was never in any script at any time ever. It's just something me and Barry used to do when we'd go away for summer season, and we'd go into a flat for the season. And I'd be happy just to put my feet up, lay back, and watch the telly, you know. But Barry would go, no, we can't leave it like this. That settee shouldn't be there. The telly should be over here, and that sideboard should be over there. And so I'd have to get up, and we'd have to help it. To you, and stuff. And then on the first series, first episode of Chuckle Vision, we had to move a desk. And it wasn't in the script, but automatically, as we picked it up, it was like, to you, said it, to you, to me, to you, to me, and put it down.
And it stuck. And
it caught on instantly caught on. It's amazing.
I'll tell you what, I don't think I've moved the couch yet, Paul, without saying it.
to this, you go, to me. Yes, has to be done.
Right, Paul, brilliant. Thanks so much for coming
Thank
on,
you
mate.
So much for your time.
Thank you. Yeah, so much for coming on.
Absolutely loved it, lads. Absolutely loved it. What a great set of guys. Great set.
Thank you so brilliant. Much, mate.
You and your Look family after yourself care. And the wife.
You take care.
And you. And you. Yeah, keep cool. Keep cool, guys.
Cheers, Paul.
Cheers, bye.
You know, lads.
Mate, I don't think you realise, you don't realise what we've just said on.
I've just said to me to you with Paul Chuckle. See you later, lads. I'm done.
Your career's done.
Done.
Your career is done.
Do you have a quick drinks break, Johnny, and then get... I don't think the gaffer's
out. I need, to be honest, mate, I need a gypsy's eye. I need a gypsy's. Mate. It's madness, that.
Paul Chuckle.
Mate, right, I need a wee, and I don't know where I'm gonna. I don't know how I'm gonna get my outfit down.
Leaving me to it again.
Pardon?
Everyone, leaving me to it again. If you've not donated and you can, please do. It's all helping out. And from one Paul to another, Paul Dickov. I think he's waiting in the green room. We'll have the, he's ready to go. And if you've not been on the quiz on Saturday, we'll be there again. I don't know if we've got a guest quizzer this week, Tony Warner, on Saturday. So get on the quiz. What else? Oh, we've got Michael Bridges coming out on Thursday. And I think we're going to release these as podcasts as well. So they'll be coming out in between just as little bonus episodes because we were doing it, so we might as well. I don't know if there's any more news. No. Oh, I'm getting messages through.
It's hard work trying to get this fucking thing off, by the way.
Put in the comments as well on YouTube, because we need to attempt to get somebody else next week. Sports star, showbiz star. I mean, our sports star, I've suggested Chris Akabusa. That's the one for me, sports star, but we'll see. And my number one, I've decided as well, my number one guest to get on, Warwick Davis. If we can get Warwick Davis on here, I'll die a happy man. No, just me talking to myself.
Yeah, Dickov's hosting a Man City quiz at 9 o'clock.
Oh, so we need to get a shift on.
Have you dropped the batch, Johnny?
Right, well, let's get him in then. Paul Dickov.
I get him in, just have to get my tits in.
Our next guest is a man, despite winning the European Cup Winners' Cup with Arsenal, enjoying two successful spells with Man City, winning a league title, three promotions and scoring 101 league goals in 421 appearances, described his biggest challenge in football as managing an arrogant little twat from Sunderland, whose name shall remain anonymous for legal reasons. Scotland international and former Oldham and Doncaster manager, Paul Dickov.
How are we, guys?
We're good.
I feel you're all right.
Yeah, but Brownie, you didn't have to put your best gear on for me coming on, mate.
The best you've seen him.
Best I've seen him in a long time.
How was he to manage, Paul?
It was an absolute nightmare. That's why I never went back into it again. to be fair, it was brilliant. Yeah, he knows that. I loved him. The season I had him there, he played in one leg half the season for me. Struggling with injuries and hardly ever trained, but every time I put him out there, it was brilliant for me. Wanted to keep him, but we ended up getting relegated and they went on to Blackburn after that. But no, he was top man.
Remember
he
when I broke his door?
Went chasing the cash at Blackburn.
Yeah, he did. He did, basically. That. So I'll try to be polite about it there, Parky.
Gaffer, remember when I broke my toe?
Yep.
He pulls it in the office Monday morning and says, Brownie, I want you to play tomorrow night. I think we're playing Charlton the next night. And I couldn't barely walk. Coming in Monday morning, I couldn't put a trainer on. And I was like, right, okay. He says, if you play tomorrow, play Saturday, you can have 3 weeks off. Get on the beach and relax.
Yeah.
I said, right, fair enough. So I've jabbed me toe. I think we ended up winning, didn't we?
We beat Charlton, yeah.
I think I scored as well. Emery. Make a note of that, Johnny.
No wonder you can remember it, mate. It fucking happened right often, didn't it?
I was going to say, it was the only one he did score that season.
I played Tuesday, played the Saturday, and then the next game was the Saturday after. So I've Friday afternoon when all the team's doing shape and set pieces and all that, I've got the free rein just to go to the gym and I think I was in the sauna. I'm sat in the sauna and the physio's going, what the fuck are you doing? I said, no, I booked my flights. The gaffer said I can have 3 weeks off. He went, no, you're playing tomorrow. Get in the shower. I think it was Brighton. You forgot all about it, hadn't you?
Well, no, I remember that. I was just surprised how gullible you were that you believed me at the time.
You've been it long enough, mate, to realise that it's like when, you know, back in the day when you're not played on a Saturday, the manager said, look, just do 60 on Monday night for the reserves. And it gets to 60 minutes and you'd be like that, looking at your fucking, looking over at the bed. The manager said, play the rest of the game. You end up doing the full fucking 90.
You always get the, how do you feel? How do you feel?
Yeah. Yeah. You can stay on, not a problem at all.
I'm fucking raging. I'm playing on a Monday night against fucking Rochdale. That's how I feel.
What are you drinking, Gaffer? Red wine?
A little glass of wine here, mate, just finishing it off. I thought I would be half sensible and wait 3 years, but I couldn't wait any longer, so...
We need to talk about that playoff final.
Oh, what one's that, mate? Oh, that one. Yeah. Yeah, go on then.
Because you're working at the club now. Do you think that's what you're remembered for? Was that one of your best days ever?
Yeah, it's got to be. You know, the work I'm doing with the club now, they've got me working as ambassador, flying here, there and everywhere. You know, been a lot of time in Asia, Australia, Indonesia. You know, whenever the club have got events on, because I'm massive now abroad there. They're sending me over to go and represent them, and it's I'm still living off the back of that goal 21 years ago, and I'm not complaining about it either.
Long may it continue.
Yeah, I only scored one goal in my career, and that was it.
we had Nicky Weaver on.
It's top man.
And he was talking about the whole thing, and it was... He wasn't happy that you got a lot of the credit and he didn't.
I'm still getting it now. He's still getting none.
I think he just wanted a job.
Manson didn't want to employ the Weaves. They're like, fuck that.
Exactly. Exactly.
We're right in saying that, obviously, in goal was your best man, Vince Bartram.
Yeah, Phil Gilliam. Yeah, me and Vince were together at Arsenal as kids, the reserves. And I was Vince's best man at his wedding. And me and Jan, my wife, are godparents to his kids, so...
Who released the first text afterwards? Was it a congratulations or was it a pleasant still, one?
I'm still texting him now about it. He's never heard the end of it nearly 21 years later.
It was that long ago. If it were text, I'd just got to send the fucking letter in post.
Carrier pigeon.
Yeah. To be fair to him, he takes it well. He dreads the 30th of May every single year because in social media he gets battered all the time.
Yeah. Was it a good celebration afterwards?
We had a decent celebration from what I can remember. It was back to one of my mates' pubs in Altrincham. And the next day, actually, I had a barbecue at my house. So it was bank holiday for all the players and staff. So I'm so glad we won. So everybody came. The only one that couldn't make it was Ian Bishop. Do you know Bishop at all?
Nah.
No, he's top. He's probably one of the funniest men I've met in football. And Bishop stayed in London because he just signed from West Ham. And he went back to his family, and all Sunday morning or the Monday morning after the game, he's calling me. Bish is serious formal. If the lads are running a night out, he can't handle it if he's not there. So anyway, but he was going out for Sunday lunch with his Jane at the time, his missus and kids, somewhere near King's Cross. So they're in the restaurant, and Bish all of a sudden tells Jane he's going to the toilet, and goes to the toilet and ends up jumping the train and coming to my house and leaving the kids in London and he's on, which was amazing.
Some boozing squad, by the way. Richard Dunn.
Dunny, Weaves. Yeah. Dunny, Weaves. Steve Howie came in at that time as well. Jeff Whitley, Mark Kennedy. So now we've got a decent squad there. The good thing about it is...
still 5 pints in a sleep.
Say that again?
He's still 5 pints in a sleep.
Who, me?
Ooh, that ain't gonna end well, Chris.
I don't know if it's a signal failure or if he's just raging.
Yeah, plays in saying, what the fuck have you just said, Brownie?
Yeah. I don't go to sleep now.
Carry on.
Remember when I were at Stoke and we played when you were at Crystal Palace?
That was brilliant, wasn't it?
We had an all-nighter and you came met us after you got treatment next day.
Yep, all the way through, wasn't it?
it was a big old session.
Yeah, I remember that. It was that leather jacket you had on that night, Parky. I think you'd licked it off of me. It was that tight on you.
I know. Not very often I went on my own, mate, when I got a leather jacket on, I'll tell you.
Did you have the vest on, Johnny? The vest? Huh? Did you have the vest on?
Oh, probably underneath, yeah.
Do you miss managing, Paul? Do you miss management?
If I'm being honest, no. I was lucky. You know, I finished playing and I sort of fell into it. I didn't even have a break. At 2.5 years at Oldham and then 2.5 years at Doncaster. And I loved every minute of it. And there's a part of me that misses it. But if I'm being honest, it nearly bloody killed me at the same time as well. Yeah. You know, nothing prepares you for it. And, you know, had some good lads, had some dickheads at the same time as well. But you've got to manage them all the same because you've not got the budget to replace players. And, you know, especially my first two seasons at Donny were tough because you'll remember this, Brownie. There was two takeovers in place for the pre-seasons. And literally the week before the season started, both fell through. So what I was planning budget-wise for my team and for the season probably get knocked 70%. And that was the week before the season started. So I was trying to persuade you to sign Brainy and stay, wasn't I? But I couldn't offer you anything because I didn't know.
It was up in the air, wasn't it?
Yeah, all the time. You know, second season there, we went to Portugal. Well, we went both seasons. First season went to Portugal pre-season. And I got told before we went that the takeover was happening. So with all these players ready to sign, and by the time I came back, which was the week before the season started, I couldn't sign any of them. And I literally had 9 players the week before the season started. And then I had 5 days to go out and sign players to try and get ready for it. So it was good for me. And a lot of the lads were brilliant. They were. But I found it difficult, the mentality, and I'm not going to lie about that. You know, I think a lot of the players, and I think especially some of the players, not a lot of the players, that's a bit wrong. They like the thought of being a footballer, but they actually don't want to do the hard work that gets them there. And that was something.
About it many times, mate, on this.
Yeah, and that was, so I couldn't, because I wasn't, I played for 20 years and I was so fortunate that I played for 20 years because I worked as hard as I could every single day. Do you know what I mean? And wanted to be the best I could every single day. And I would see some players in training thinking that the dog's bollocks. And for me as a manager, because these players were contracted and my hands were tied, so I couldn't just tell them to do one and leave.
That was because, really more frustrating, weren't it?
Yeah, it was.
Fuck off, mate.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Because, you know, if you get rid of them, or you call them in and say you want to get rid of them, they want to stay there on the money that they're on. They're not bothered. But then you've not got the money to go and replace them. So it was a massive learning thing for me. And I'm not going to lie to you, there's still a small part of me that still misses it. But that's the competitive side. That's the match day side. That's being involved with the lads and everything else. But the side as in dealing with boards and agents and some players, I don't miss that at all.
Gaffer, one thing that for me personally, I'll never forget it, was I was having a bit of a shit time. I think we got spanked at Bournemouth. I think it was five,
yeah.
And I was a bag of shit. I was struggling. I don't think I'd scored for a few games, which you'll appreciate, Johnny.
Yeah.
I thought
this was January, right? His last goal was August.
Yeah.
We came to the set. I think we played Wigan, and I was expecting not to play. Yeah. Obviously, I think Sharpie might have been there, Theo and a few of the other lads. Yeah. And I've come into the game not thinking I was playing. And just before the teams were announced, the gaffers pulled us. And he went, just don't worry about what's going on. I know you haven't scored for a while. Just keep doing what you're doing. You're going to be playing every single week for me. And just don't worry about it. Just play your normal game. And did we beat them 3-0?
Yeah, we did. We battered them, actually, didn't we?
Within 10 minutes, I'd scored. Yeah. Obviously, at that time, that's what I needed to hear.
Was that when you say struggling, would you mean confidence or physically?
I mean, Johnny, know, like, and the gaffer knows that if you're a striker and you haven't scored and you're not playing well for 4 or 5 games, you're looking over your shoulder.
Yeah.
Thinking you're going to be, and probably rightly so.
You weren't training either.
Nah.
You know, you were playing a Saturday and you'll come in the Monday. And my thing with Brownie and a lot of the players was, and you'll get this, Parky, players know their own bodies better than the managers do. You know, for me as the manager, as long as Brownie was doing what he was doing for me on the Saturday, I didn't really care what he was doing Monday to Thursday, because I knew what I was getting from him. You know, I mean, and even that point when he was struggling, he was still contributing to the team, and I could relate to that myself. You know, because I went through loads of spells where you were having a stinker and you weren't scoring goals, but once you know, you get the appreciation of your manager and your teammates, because the teammates love Brownie as well, and I don't want to turn this into a loving for them.
Teammates are the biggest one, I think. As long as you feel validated by the lads,
yeah,
you can call it right, I think.
And what he was doing for the lads and what he was doing for me as his manager was way beyond him scoring goals, you know what I mean? What he was giving me week in, week out, at a time when we were struggling as well, because I knew exactly what I was going to get.
We know you've got to be gone for 9, Paul, so we've got a quick quiz for you on Man City.
I'm a boring you already.
A minute on the clock. A minute on the clock. Easy questions. Go. What's the name of the stadium?
Etihad Stadium.
What song is played before kickoff of every match?
One Paul Dickov. No, Blue Moon.
The capacity of the Etihad to the nearest 1,000?
55.
Correct. Who is the club's mascot?
Manchester.
Correct. Club record signing.
Oh. Rodri.
Correct. Who is the manager before Pep?
Pellegrini.
Correct. Who scored Man City's first goal in the League Two playoff final against Gillingham?
Kevin Orlock.
Correct.
And he doesn't get any credit either. Brilliant.
Who's the current sponsor on the front of the shirt?
Etihad Airways.
Club's record goal scorer.
Aguero.
Who owns City Football Group?
Sheikh Mansour.
Who assisted Aguero for his famous title clincher against QPR?
Balotelli.
Correct.
Time.
How many are we talking, John? 11.
11?
Oh! Yeah.
It's up there.
You've gone above Andy Wyman.
You've gone above Kirk off Coronation Street.
Kirkoff, it's Dickov, mate, not Kirkoff.
That's what I'm going for a weekend next time we can fly. Yeah.
You're our number one guest.
I'll join you.
Number one guest with 11. Unbelievable.
I'll take that. If I didn't know that, working for the club, there's something wrong, isn't there?
Yeah.
We didn't really get you sacked.
But
Brownie done that at Doncaster for me.
You're not the only one.
Brilliant. Well, cheers, Rafa,
thanks very much for coming.
Thank you very much for your time.
Great to see you guys.
Enjoy your quiz.
Thank you very much for coming on, Paul.
Enjoy your quiz.
Man. Thank you. Cheers, guys.
Brilliant. Thanks a lot. Quiz. Still gaffer. Always gaffer.
It's got to be.
Oh, yeah. We're a bit creepy now. Yeah.
Are you gaffer?
I went back to the stadium a couple of years ago and Peter Reid wasn't, like, I wasn't even in the first team when I was there. I was like 16, 17, and I still find myself calling him gaffer.
Yeah. Well, we've got a man in the green room that I don't want to keep waiting, lads.
Wait a minute. Let me just get my touch on. If it comes on mid-interview, I'm not bothered.
Straighten your pint.
Let's let him in, Matthew. From the green room. Here he is. Sideways. Our final guest of the evening is a man not to be messed with. 12 years professional wrestling career, going from marine biologist to bare-knuckle fighter to WWE superstar. Bad News Barrett, King Barrett, Wade Barrett, The Lord. He's a wrestler, he's a presenter, he's a goddamn Hollywood actor. From Preston to Sunset Boulevard, it's Stu Bennett. How are we doing? Can you hear us?
We're in. Are we working?
We're in!
He's here.
Yes.
Hey, they don't make wrestlers that intelligent. I've got to be honest with you guys.
What happened?
Nice to be in, finally. Pen and paper. Next time, can we do a written version?
How are we doing?
I don't know if you've realised, Paul, but we're having a wrestling night.
You didn't tell me it was fancy dress. Now I feel really
stupid. Every week.
Not only can I not walk in, I also didn't dress up.
Who's best dressed?
Say that again?
Who's best dressed?
There's a performance.
I'd have to go with you, Chris, actually. The hardest thing in wrestling is getting face paint right. So that alone, you've won it.
Especially doing it on your own, you know. I was doing it on your own.
Hold on. I did come prepared, kind of. Hang on.
Oh, Mysterio.
There we go. It's kind of a rip-off version. I bought it in a bar in Mexico once.
Well, look at state of that. My fucking tash has come off. Look at that, man.
I can't keep that on. Horrible. How are you guys doing anyway?
Good, man.
All good, Paul. All good.
I was Mr. Chuckle. I missed him.
Oh, man.
What a man.
What a good man, indeed.
I saw a bit of Lee Trundle.
They say never meet your heroes, mate, but I've met mine and I'm more than happy with it.
Where are you now, mate?
I'm actually in Los Angeles. I live here now. I've been out in the US for about 13 years, so I moved to LA about a year ago.
Yeah. Are you filming at the minute? Oh, obviously not at the minute with lockdown, but have you been doing a film with Vinnie Jones?
Yeah, I did film that about a year ago. It was actually supposed to come out in May, but I think everything, because of the lockdowns, all being pushed back. Obviously, theatres and stuff are closed. But yeah, that was a great experience. Obviously, Vinny's a He's a crazy guy. I don't know if you guys know Vinny at all, but man, he is crazy. So, so much fun to be around. And I'm a big football fan. Obviously, I was born in 1980. So one of the first FA Cup finals that I vividly remember was the 88 final.
Yeah.
Wimbledon against Liverpool. And obviously, he was the don of that team. And you know, every break we had in filming for 4 weeks, I was just pestering Vinny nonstop for stories about the crazy gang. And tell me about John Fashanu. Tell me about Dennis Wise. I think he was glad to see the back of me by the end of it. But yeah, a lot of fun working with him at the film. It's called I Am Vengeance Retaliation. So keep an eye out for it. I'm not sure when it's going to be coming out. It's going to be out in the next few months. But people can follow me on my Twitter and I update everything on there.
Dude, how does somebody from Preston, how does somebody go from Preston to the big stage? The wrestling, the acting? How did it come
I mean, the wrestling came first because of the success in the wrestling. The acting stuff came from that. But I was just an obsessive wrestling fan as a kid, as I assume you probably were in the 80s or early 90s.
Ooh,
most
yeah.
people were of our kind of generation. And I can see that the guys you're dressed up as are guys that I was a massive fan of myself. But the difference was, whereas most people kind of grew out of it as they got in their teens and got into other things, I stuck with it and I was always a huge fan. And even in my early 20s, I was like, God, I've got to do something about that. I was always very athletic. I'm 6'6", too, which helps. So I was always big. And I knew I wanted to give it a shot. And I found a tiny little wrestling school in the UK. And I started wrestling in pubs in front of like 5 or 6 people and traveling across the country for hundreds of miles only to get paid whatever I used in petrol, basically. So that's how I started off, and eventually I got a bit better and a bit better, and WWE took me and brought me out to the States in 2007.
Is that right? Before you did the wrestling, you were in the bare knuckle trade?
Yeah, that's all a load of nonsense. We kind of hyped that up as a character, a bit like the Ultimate Warrior wasn't really an Ultimate Warrior. And yeah, the Macho Man, he kind of was pretty macho, actually, but...
You've killed me, right?
I'm sorry. I mean, I've been in a few pub fights. That's the reason. Do you remember a guy called Dusty Rhodes? He was kind of a very big wrestler in the 80s and 90s. Well, he was one of the guys training me out in the US. And he liked the fact that I've got a really beat-up nose, you can probably see quite obviously there. So I was in a few playground fights and pub fights and things like that when I was younger. So my nose got pretty beat up. So he wanted to bring that into my character, and we kind of embellished a few fight stories and made me the bare knuckle fighting champion of Europe. So that was where that all came from.
We were having a discussion beforehand.
Frozen.
Yeah, I think he has, yeah. We were having a discussion beforehand, and I was just going off the Wikipedia page, which goes along with the story. And I was saying that you know, you've been, I could imagine you at uni as you was in Liverpool, just all the other lads are going working at Costa in the cinema, and you were going down to old mills like bare knuckle fighting for a couple of hundred quid here and there. You've just destroyed your dream.
I'm about 18 and a half stone now. The heaviest I was when I was wrestling was about 20 stone. When I was in university, I was 6'6", but about 12 stone. I was skin and bone, and like, was when I decided I wanted to be a wrestler, and I was like, I've got this great idea, I'm gonna be a really weird. Obviously, looking at me, that's all at 6'6" and 12 stone, people were just laughing, saying it's ridiculous. But that's when I started hitting the gym and eating a ton of food and pumping iron every day and slowly putting that weight on. But I was definitely not the bare knuckle fighting champion of the world. in Liverpool when I was 12 stone, that's definitely not why.
You got a bit slap at 12 stone.
I was fighting some weaklings at that point. I definitely wasn't fighting the world's best bare knuckle fighters. I was picking my spots, picking my moments.
Was there a moment when you got to WWE, you know, like you're saying, you're a massive fan, it's your dream to get there, and when you finally got there, was there any starstruck moments? Was there a pinch myself moment?
Yeah, definitely. There was a moment where the entire roster of WWE, and I was the new guy at this time, so this was in 2010, I think. The entire roster of WWE, we all had to get on this plane together to fly to WrestleMania. And like 99% of the seats on this plane were all WWE wrestlers, but there was about six seats left, which just regular people had bought. And I remember thinking to myself, wow, how cool would it be if you're a massive wrestling fan and then you got on this plane and the entire roster of people was on this plane and you were like the only regular person who wasn't in the
one of them six.
And then I suddenly stopped myself and I thought, the only thing that would be even cooler than that would be to be one of the fucking wrestlers. And now I was like, well, that's where I'm at. So I thought, that was a pinch yourself moment. But I was kind of jealous of the people who weren't wrestlers sat on the plane. And I went, no, it's even better because I am one of them.
Athletes, aren't you? And you've got to learn to get fucking beat up, really, ain't you?
Mm. I've been beat up by everyone. Even Wayne Rooney beat me up. So I've been beaten up by the whole world. But at the end of the day, it's entertainment. We're not trying to portray it ever as being a real sport or a real competitive fight. Because if you watch real wrestling in the Olympics and stuff, it's generally pretty boring for most people. So we have to try and do entertaining things to get millions of people around the world watching it. So, you absolutely have to be an athlete and you get beat. I'm covered in scars. I've snapped my arm. I've got a giant 12-inch scar here from where I've been sliced open and repaired and stuff. But that's the nature of it. As you guys know, you're pretty beat up from your football careers too.
It weren't fucking Hulk Hogan who sliced you, were it? Because if it were, I'd take his helmet off now.
I got to thank you both anyway. There was a game so I'm from Preston, and obviously you both used to play for PNE, but I spent a lot of my youth growing up in Cardiff. So the vast majority of my friends are Cardiff City fans. And in 2009, PNE beat Cardiff City 6-0, and you both scored that day. So this game is brought up with regularity in all my conversations with my mates back home, constantly sending them the video of all the goals and stuff like that. So thank you both for that. You're a great argument ender. 6-0.
Yeah. More than happy to help, mate. More than happy to help.
You know what? How would this be off the top rope? Just getting one of them in the grid. Bosh.
Yeah, to that, man.
Oh, Jesus. What I see that, Stu.
On a serious note, like, you know, living in LA, are you, like, sat having something to eat in a restaurant and one of them fucking Kardashian things comes in?
I haven't seen that. I'm trying to think. I can't think of any famous people I've seen since I've moved to LA. I literally can't think of any. And I've been here a year now, and people you walk around and just bump into my... I know Arnold Schwarzenegger rides his bike around my neighbourhood, apparently. I've never seen him. But yeah, it's not something I've really come across. Maybe I'm going to the wrong place. I'm going to cheap bars. I don't go to the posh places. So Kim Kardashian isn't in the dog down the road.
That's depression in you. That's the depression in you.
A lot of the stories on the podcast, Stu, obviously about the football dressing room banter, going out. What's it like in that wrestling environment? You know, what's that dressing room like? I mean, I don't want to generalise. I imagine there's a few hotheads, a few angry birds here and there.
there is. Birds. I mean, in this day and age, generally it's very, very, very professional. WWE, who I wrestled most of my career for, is like a publicly listed company and we're all drug tested and we all have to be good boys. And anything you do wrong in this day and age, as you guys know, is all over social media and stuff like that. So in my era that I was there, it was very well behaved. If you go back 25 or 30 years during the era of the guys you're all dressed up as, it was the Wild West, apparently. And I've heard a lot of crazy stories from that era of how the guys were behaving. But nowadays, it's a lot tamer. There's always good banter, but everyone at that level, for the most part, is very, very professional. And it's kind of a boring answer. I know that's not what you wanted, but,
It must have got better, you know, like, since this women's wrestling's got more popular.
Yeah.
It must have been a lot more interesting in that in them dressing rooms when all the nice looking fit young ladies came in.
I mean, they eyes are always there actually in my time there, but they were generally treated treated like models, but now they're seen as serious wrestlers and stuff like that. So yeah, I mean, there's a lot of interrelationships going on between the male and the female locker room. I will say
that's
that.
That's exactly what we need to hear.
I turned up at P&E about 2011 or 2012, something like that, and they had me do a team talk for the players and all that stuff. And obviously, I grew up a massive P&E fan, so that was a huge treat for me. And I remember talking to the players after Sky Sports were there and they filmed it and all that stuff. And they all left and I hung around with the players for 20 minutes and they were all complaining because I didn't bring any of the divas with me. So, like, when you want to meet you, we don't give a shit about you. Bring the girls.
I was there. I remember it. You miss it. You miss being involved with the WWE.
Yes and no. There's elements of it I miss, but to be honest with you, I was on the road and wrestling 250 to 270 nights a year, and I'm 39 now. I was getting beat up and tired and kind of fed up a bit. I'm still involved in wrestling. I do commentary these days. I'm commentating for a company called NWA, which is almost like a startup company. It's owned by Billy Corgan, who's the singer of the Smashing Pumpkins. So that's been doing pretty well. So people go check that out if you want to see what I'm up to now. But at some point, I am going to get back in the ring. I'm not done. The thing about wrestling is you can kind of go on forever. If you watch Ric Flair, he was wrestling when he was 60, and Hulk Hogan was wrestling when he was 60, and you can always come back. And a little. There you go.
It must be frustrating, though, you know, putting your body through that and being an athlete, but yet, you know, if you're a footballer, the better you do, the more successful you are, but your fate is in the hands of script writers, essentially, no matter how much you put yourself through. And there must have been moments when that's really frustrating.
100%, and it's like anything in the world of entertainment. There's a lot of politics involved, there's favoritism and stuff like that, and that was absolutely, for me, the most frustrating thing at all, is there wasn't a linear progression between endeavor and success. In my mind, if things are working, then keep going with this, but that isn't how it works in professional wrestling. Well, it's the same in acting or anything. Like, you can be the best actor in the world, but if your job is to simply pull a pint in the Rover's Return, no one's ever going to know. So that's the nature of the beast in the entertainment game, and definitely that's something that I would have preferred to be in the sporting world as opposed to the entertainment world, because I do like that linear relationship between
success. I'll be perfectly honest with you, right? As long as I got paid the most money, you could kick the shit out of me every night, 365 days. I've got knocked to fucking shit for 365 days, literally. Well, I've got to pay more money than being a champion. Fuck it.
Well, actually, Grant Holt became a wrestler. For
he did.
Maybe there's something we had him on. We'll sell out Deedale. Maybe John the Beast Parkin against Stu the Beast Bennett.
That's it. Deedale sell out. That needs setting up.
Get me over. To be fair, he said it was so much harder than what he ever imagined it would be.
Yeah, you underestimated it.
A lot of MMA guys, like there's a guy called Ken Shamrock, who, if you watched early UFC, he was one of the top names. He was one of the top fighters. He was UFC heavyweight champion. But in his career, he moved from UFC and he came to wrestle for WWE. And he said after that that the risk of getting hurt and the amount of effort and energy it takes to be a WWE wrestler was so much more difficult than it was in UFC. And don't get me wrong, I'm not going to go to the UFC and tell those guys they ain't tough because they're a bunch of badasses. But in terms of the lifestyle and the craft, wrestling is, you know, so much tougher.
Is the training the same, Stu? Is the training the same? Do you still have to work out as hard as what they do?
I've done a little MMA when I was younger. And in terms of the training for WWE, it's just completely different. It's a lot more repetition. I think one of the biggest differences is that if you're in a UFC fight, obviously the aim really is to hurt your opponent and injure your opponent. In wrestling, the aim is to not injure your opponent. So we're trying our best to walk a very fine line in wrestling between making it look good and making it look painful while simultaneously not trying to kill your opponent and break his neck and stuff like that. So we're going along in fourth gear, whereas they're in a fight, they're in fifth gear, they're foot to the floor and you know, smashing it as hard as they can, so they can't possibly fight like that 250 nights a year, whereas we're holding back a bit and that's how we're able to wrestle 250 matches a year or whatever it is.
What was Brock Lesnar like Stu, because he looks one of the scariest men I've ever seen. Ever.
He doesn't.
He is. He's a very intense guy. He's absolutely massive. Like, I've been around, obviously, all the wrestlers, but there was no one who ever looked like him. I'm taller than him, but he looks like he's three times the size of me. Yeah. He's just this. He's a pretty big guy, but.
Sorry, I read that he's one of only two men that has to wear four XXXL gloves in MMA.
Oh, right.
He must be humongous.
I imagine so. I've never wrestled him. I had to do a spot once where him and The Undertaker were in a brawl, and I was one of the guys sent to split them up, which is a horrible job to get. Nobody wants that job. You don't get paid very much for it, and the risk of getting absolutely leathered by one of his punches or something like that is huge. So I was sent because I was one of the bigger guys, and at one point I grabbed him around the waist from behind to try and pull him away from The Undertaker, and as I'm behind him like this, he swings his elbow, and I just felt the air just missed my nose, and his elbow when I was like that.
You'd have been on the floor, Chris.
Just missed. At that point, I let him go, and I was like, I'm done. They're not paying me enough for it. I just walked in the locker room. I was like, you guys deal with that. I'm not. Just missed me. I was like, oh, this nose is battered enough as it is. I don't need any more. So.
I'd have been out.
I was. I left. Got to the rental car and hit the next town.
You've just mentioned him there. Eh? I think he's probably my all-time wrestling hero, The Undertaker. Is it still the same guy? He must be 7. He must be 96, isn't he?
Yeah, I mean, it's the same guy. There's no part of his body that is still original. They've replaced everything at this point. Like his hips, his knees, everything's been repaired, and it's all titanium and stuff like that now. But yeah, the cool thing about him is he doesn't wrestle much anymore. He wrestles like once a year or something like that, and he's very beat up. But the coolest thing about him is, in my opinion, was the entrance. When the lights go down, you start hearing dong, dong, and the crowd going up. So one of the coolest things.
Up there.
That's it. And one of the coolest things I did in my career was have to wrestle him and just standing in the ring. I do my entrance, everyone's booing. I get on the mic, say some stuff, and then suddenly the lights go completely silent. The crowd goes crazy. And he does this 20-minute slow walk to the ring. But just being in the ring and witnessing that and then thinking, you know, when the lights come up, oh, shit, I got wrestling now. This is one of them. And it didn't last very long. It lasted about 30 seconds. I was finished. Tombstone. But it was a good experience anyway.
You got voted the most hated wrestler in 2010. That must be... I mean, it's a weird thing to think, yeah, but that was your job, to be the bad guy. Exactly. So that must have been an accolade.
Yeah, so I spent my whole career as a bad guy. I always wanted to be the bad guy. I was never going to be the guy who slaps hands and kisses babies and stuff like that. So to be voted the most hated wrestler is a huge pat on the back, really, because you know, it's like every movie. You need a bad guy and you need a good guy. The better the bad guy is, the better the good guy is going to look when he eventually wins. So, yeah, absolutely, that's a big pat on the back. And the cool thing about that was, in 2009, I was completely unknown because I was wrestling very small time. In 2010, I really hit the big time in a big way. So I went from being completely unknown to being the top bad guy in professional wrestling in a very short space of time. So really cool experience. Just crazy to go from that to having the wrestling spotlight completely on me.
Stu, did you have an agent? How did you get picked up from all of a sudden being at the top of the WWE? What was the crack?
Yeah, no agent. They do regular tours of the UK, and they I think they're in either Manchester Arena or Earl's Court, and I just sent them some pictures of me in a crappy video of my matches in a pub or something like that, and they invited me along for the day. And then when I got there, all the wrestlers were. This was during the day before the fans came in. All the wrestlers were stood around the ring, all like The Undertaker and. You know, whoever the top guys were at that point, John Cena and Randy Orton and all these guys. And then they made me and a couple of other guys get in the ring and show them what we could do. Which, if you're surrounded by all these superstar wrestlers who you're a big fan of, and you're just this nobody dweeb from Preston, and you're like, get in the ring, show The Undertaker how to do it. Like, oh, it was awful. So we get in the ring and we have to wrestle around a bit and, you know, part of crappy matches. There's no crowd, so there's no one cheering or booing, and you're surrounded by all these superstars just staring at you. But apparently they liked what they saw because they offered me a developmental contract to come over to the UK, which is kind of like the equivalent of a YTS scheme thing in football where you find young guys, bring them over, pay them next to nothing, and they've got to learn the ropes for the next couple of years. So that was my way in. That's how I got into the company. And fortunately, I continued progressing in Kentucky and Florida and wrestling in these very small circuits. And eventually, they brought me on to the main roster.
Mackie, our moderator, a massive wrestling fan, and it's a bit past my era of watching, but he told me to ask about is it the Nuox and the CM Punk era, and what's going on?
Oh, the Nexus?
Yes, that's it.
Yeah, Nexus was 2010. That was when I was the top bad guy in wrestling. I was leading a group of young guys who were kind of invading the WWE. That was the storyline, and CM Punk. That was another one from that era. He was a guy who was very popular. We didn't really do too much together, myself and CM Punk. We were always bad guys at the same time for the most part, so we didn't really interact too much. So you don't want two bad guys fighting each other because the crowd doesn't cheer for anyone.
Are you still following Preston Stu?
I am, yeah. I don't get to see them too often live these days. Obviously, living out here, I think over the last kind of 10 years, I've probably seen 5 games live. But I have an app these days called iFollow, so I get every game streamed live on the internet on this app, which unfortunately, because I'm now living here in LA, it's on at like 7 a.m. or something like that on a Saturday morning. But at least I get to watch it. So, yeah, fully up to speed.
Did you ever watch us two dickheads playing, Stu?
Yeah, of course. I never got to see you live. I think you two were both there as I just moved over to the US, so I never got to see you guys live. But obviously, I saw the clips and stuff like that. And,
Would you swap? This is probably a stupid question.
I would.
your career in the WWE and you're acting for a 5-year contract at Preston.
Yeah, 100%. I think they asked me that when I came and trained at Deep Dell, and I do it in a heartbeat. My first aim as a young boy was to be a professional footballer, as I think most people of my class or age group were. And I was a decent player. I'd be playing in Sunday league teams and for local teams and stuff like that. I was never in danger of ever being a professional footballer. But yeah, of course, I'd love to have that experience of going out. And I'm still, to this day, there's still that little bit of a dream where Alex Neil is, oh, we've only got 10 players, what can we do? The phone rings. Yeah, I'll be there.
Ring Bennett.
It's still in my head.
Get Bennett on the blower now.
Well, if you ask that, right, I would swap my life for Stu's.
100%.
Would you?
I really would.
I'm beat up.
I swear to God, I really would.
No, it's. I mean, it's. It's like anything, you know. It's one of those things. The grass is always greener. All you ever see as a fan of something is the very best moments. All I ever see of John Barkin and Chris Brown is when they're on the pitch and the YouTube highlight reel of them scoring the goals and stuff like that. What you don't see is getting up at 6 a.m. on a cold January morning and training in the driving rain and then getting injured in training and being out and struggling for a new contract. It's the same in wrestling. You don't see me sitting on planes in tiny little seats over and over and over again. So the grass is always greener. You see the cool bit, you don't see the grass.
Set Boulevard when I go out my fucking drive.
Betsy won't like it there anyway, John.
I would swap it tomorrow. I'll have a look at it. Don't be Rey Mysterio, no bother.
You two must be thrilled at how things have turned out, though, with the podcast and all that stuff. Actually, a couple of my mates were supposed to be going to see the show in Cardiff at the Motorpoint Arena. They got tickets for it. It's my brother and another friend. So, like, the success you've had there is impressive. It's the same for, you know, it's one thing if you're Steve McManaman and you've, you know, played for Real Madrid and you've won the Champions League and all this stuff. And it's very easy for a guy like that to parlay that success into something else. But the guys who played in the lower divisions, and even me as a wrestler, you know, I'm not John Cena, but trying to parlay that into something else. I'm always impressed when I see people able to find a new route in life like you have them. So hats off to Barry for doing
that.
Somehow we're doing all right.
We were meant to be in New York. Saturday just gone. With Sean St. Ledger.
I don't know if that's Football Factory. There we go.
That's it.
Oh man. Yeah, Sean's a good guy. I think he invited me out to play darts that night and I couldn't go. I had to get back down to London.
That's code for hitting the nightclubs.
You want to go and play some darts?
You look younger now than you did on that photo.
What's that?
You look younger now than you did on that photo.
Oh, do I? Yeah, maybe.
The LA with Botox and all that, Jobby.
But maybe it's the just for men in the beard.
Well, you know, we've done a quiz, a Preston North End based.
Oh God, here we go.
60 seconds right on the clock.
All right then.
Are you going for the clock, Chris, or do you want the questions?
I'll get the clock.
You get the clock. Tell me when. They're easy questions.
I'll just go with my fingers.
I've gone easy on you, Stu.
You've got Paul Dickov and Kirk from Coronation Street at the top of the pile on 11 and 10 in a minute. So,
wow, in a minute? Wow, Jesus.
Here we go. Are we ready?
Are we ready?
Count me in.
3, 2, 1.
The stadium name?
Deep Dell.
Who is the club's mascot?
Deep Dell Duck.
Who was the manager before Alex Neil? You can pass.
Simon Grayson.
Yes. To the nearest 1,000, what's the capacity of Deepdale?
24,000.
Yes. Current league position?
6th.
Correct. True or false, Preston are far superior than Blackburn?
Absolutely true. Yes.
Club record signing?
Michael Appleton.
Ooh, Tom Bayliss. Who wears the number 1 shirt this season?
Pass.
Declan Rudd. The brand sponsor on the front of the shirt?
Bet. Sponsor. 888 or something.
32 Nine. Bet. Oh, what are we on?
Started off well.
What? Did we get the shirt?
Struggling counting his fingers here.
Did we get the shirt sponsor?
No, we didn't get the shirt sponsor. Six.
It's six.
Should have got Declan Rudd. Hey. That's embarrassing.
You're nestled between John Parkin and Paul Chuckle.
Okay, that's a pretty good spot
excellent
to be in.
you're a young boy growing up, you would have got on the reach of that, wouldn't you? Just nestled between John Parkin and Paul Chuckle.
Career highlight.
Where's he gone? Ultimate Warrior.
Backroom break.
So what?
So are you all in lockdown now at the minute then?
I haven't been outside for 6 weeks at this point. I haven't left the house. So the highlight of the day is taking the rubbish down to the garbage disposal. That's my exercise. Well, I work out in the bedroom, so to speak.
You're in a fucking position, mate, I'll be honest with you.
Yeah, completely on lockdown. All the beaches. I live 15 minutes from Santa Monica Beach, and all the beaches are closed and not allowed to them or anything. So I think the lockdown here is a little more strict than it is in the UK.
What are you doing for shopping and that then?
Delivery, like, Amazon delivery. Like the. I speak to my parents actually, and they think the delivery system here is a lot better than the UK. They've been having problems. I know getting food delivered and stuff like that, but you can get everything in LA anyway. I don't know about the rest of the country, but it's all delivered straight to the door. Booze too. I've got a regular booze delivery, which is keeping me safe.
John has as well. I don't know if you've noticed.
No, I didn't know that. It's early here. That's the only reason I'm not like John right now. If it had been 9 at night over here, then I'd be exactly the same. I'd be passing out.
So what's in the pipeline, Stu, for when the lockdown's over and we get back to normality?
I literally turned the page on my diary for the next 4 months, and there's nothing in it right now. It's completely blank. So everything got cancelled. So who knows? I mean, I've got this film coming out, so I'll be doing some promotion with that at some point. And the other thing is the wrestling that I'm doing at the moment, the wrestling commentary and stuff. But again, like football, it all got cancelled because you need people gathered in massive numbers to make wrestling shows and stuff. So until we get a clearer picture on what's going on, I've got absolutely nothing planned. So very excited to come on podcasts like this and actually have something to do. So,
is the film? Have you finished filming with Vinny?
Yeah, finished filming about a year ago. So when you finish filming, it takes pretty much a year to get everything edited together and, you know, redub some of the sound and then get the distribution deals figured out and all that stuff. So they, the people behind the film, Evolutionary Films, have been doing that for the last year. And it's, I've seen the final cut. I had to do a little DVD type commentary for it about a month or probably 2 months ago now, just before everything got locked down. So it's ready to go. I know they were planning a small theatrical release in the cinemas, so that's why it's now been held back. So whether we still go ahead with the theatrical release or not, I don't know. It might just end up straight on the, you know, the Netflix or whatever it goes on these days, whatever electronic distribution they have. So it's ready to go anyway. And, yeah, very excited for it. I'm the good guy. Vinnie Jones is the bad guy.
Oh, you're the good guy.
Another footballer is beating me up. So that's the job.
Matt. Sorry.
I'm making a great career being beaten up by footballers. So John, I'm right for the picking right now.
I got a funny joke, right? But it was about 47 seconds ago, so it's not gonna work now.
Just go for it.
Fuck it.
All right.
Oh, Stu, cheers. What was the one match that was the pinnacle for you?
I actually, believe it or not, my debut as a wrestler, I wrestled as the Pinnacle. That was my first ever wrestling name. The reason I chose it was in 2004. And I wrestled as the Pinnacle because I thought, you know what? I really like the wrestler, The Rock. And I was like, what's even cooler than The Rock? It's the Pinnacle because it's the top of the Rock. But that lasted one show. I was like, God, that's a shit name. I've got to come up with something else. But I'd say if I had to pick one match in my career that was kind of the biggest one, certainly at the time, I think I had better matches, but it was a match I had with John Cena in 2010. It was a show called Hell in a Cell, and I was the main event, and it was a very big test for me as a young up-and-coming wrestler to go one-on-one with John Cena, who was at the time the biggest star in wrestling, and the match got a great reaction, and that was kind of my moment where I knew I'd made it. No matter what happened now, I'd had this really big match, it'd gone well, and stuff like that. So to go from an unknown 6 months earlier to wrestling the biggest name in wrestling on the biggest show was very cool for me. So. Yeah.
Did you win it?
I did win that. I wrestled John Cena probably 100 times in my career. I won one, and that was the one.
That's the one. That's all that matters. That's all that matters.
Lost every other one, but that one I won. So yeah.
I don't suppose you've got John Cena's number, have you? We can get him on next Wednesday.
I think I do, actually. We haven't spoken for a long time, though. I don't know.
Not since that win.
He hangs around with real stars now. He doesn't. He probably wouldn't answer to me. He's got Vin Diesel and people like that. He's probably blocked my number.
Thanks very much for coming on, mate.
No wrong.
Unbelievable. Thank you.
And congrats again for your success. Really cool you got this going. I'm very impressed with all of you. So, and thanks again for that 6-0 against Cardiff. I'll never, ever not answer the phone to you guys. Whatever you guys need, just let me know. We have that 6-0 from 2000.
Well, thank you very much.
All right, all the best with everything.
Good
health.
See you, mate. Bye-bye.
Cheers, bye. Mate. Thank you very much.
Can I take this hood off now? No.
Fucking
hellfire.
Are you sweaty, Johnny?
Eh?
Are you sweating?
Stu Bennett.
I'm not sweaty. I tied it too tight.
Yeah, what a man.
What a man.
Fucking Jesus Christ. Is that the end of a show?
It is, lads. It is, lads. I enjoyed that very much. Who are we going for next week? We need to get everybody on it because they've done us proud up to now with a Twitter pestering.
It just shows the power of social media, doesn't it? Within 12 hours, Paul Chuckle had replied saying, 100%, I'd love to come on.
Yeah, you've got Benno on, ain't you?
Yeah.
You had Benno anyway.
Can we call him Benno? Or...
Of course we can.
He's calling anybody anything tonight.
Of course we can. We can call him Benno.
You're giving me shit for calling Dickov the gaffer.
Oh, yeah.
You're like Red Riding Hood now.
Red Riding Hood.
Uncle Albert.
Well, I hope everybody enjoyed the show.
So do I. Who are we putting out there? Who do we want on next week?
Can we actually call it a show? Can we call it a show?
Call it whatever you want, John. Chris, any suggestions?
Yeah. What about Akabusi?
Chris Akabusi.
He's active, isn't he? I think he's a football fan.
Yeah.
What?
He's a big football fan.
Chris Akabusi.
Let's go.
What about what about a theme? Dress theme?
Well, if you get Chris Akabusi on, we'll come as Olympic runners, can't we?
Olympians. Let's not.
Yeah. Olympians.
I've got something in mind, and he's not a runner.
What Olympians can we have if it's not a runner?
I'm using these glasses again. Old Eddie.
Did we go all right, lads?
I very much enjoyed that.
So it flew over. Last week was a struggle to a point, but tonight flew over.
Yeah, but we've still done 2 hours 20.
So we're going Chris Akabusi. Do we need a bit of help on the showbiz?
On his Twitter thing?
Yeah, if we go Chris Akabusi, and if we can get some help on the showbiz, who are we going for? I'd like Warwick Davis, but...
Is he a football fan?
I don't know if he is. He was on... But still.
So we're having a... Right, so Chris Akabusi for the sports star.
Yeah.
I've pulled up a parody. It's a parody, lads.
What, Akabusi?
Is he definitely on Twitter, Chrissy?
I've no idea. I've no idea. We'll find him. We'll get the Twitter links in in the comments.
So we need somebody who's a singer or actor.
Les Dennis.
Yes. Les Dennis.
Dennis. Yeah. Les Dennis. As long as 1 week we can try for Warwick Davis. We'll build that one up.
I just don't think he's a football fan.
I'm sure he's a...
Knowing Warwick as I do, I don't think he... I've never known him like football.
It doesn't matter to be a football fan, does it? Fuck it.
One day we'll have Warwick.
Is he your main man?
Forget the bird, follow the river.
What a film.
Who's that? On a serious note then, who's this tool then?
Chris Akabusi, Les Dennis.
Right, so you need to... The only thing I can ask Les Dennis, mate, is how did she smell?
Who?
How did Olden smell? The only question I need to ask Les, how did Olden smell?
Is that Lucy going bananas?
Oh, well, she's upstairs. She's probably laughing.
Or
shopping knives or something. I don't know what it would smell.
We can't ask that.
John,
Chris Akabusi, Les Dennis, let's see what we can do.
We've got no chance of getting Les on if you're asking questions.
Especially if
you've
seen that.
Well, I'm not,
or Bradley Walsh. Bradley Walsh is a big football fan.
Yeah.
Someone's just putting in the comments.
Twitter-based?
Yeah.
One of them two. We could have them both on. See what you can do. Right, thanks for watching, everyone. We'll be on the quiz again on Saturday. We hope everyone's keeping safe.
Johnny?
Yeah. Mate, I've lost my wig now, fuck it.
Oh,
can we?
Oh, yeah.
Can we have your entrance just one more time, Chrissy, please?
I can't remember how it went.
Get the we want music and all.
Oh, I can't do music now. It's gone. Well. Speaker's gone. He's took it.
Oh, yeah. The Macho Man Randy Savage and Undr The Cosh. Oh, yeah, baby. Oh, yeah. We're the cream of the crop, baby. The cream of the crop.
Could you say Michael Bridges is out on Patreon tomorrow in that accent?
No,
Michael Bridges Undr The Cosh tomorrow on Patreon. Farmer Giles, then. Oh,
yeah. Ended up sounding like fucking Captain Jack Sparrow at end.
Right, thanks for watching, everyone.
Yeah.
We'll be back next week. We'll be back on Saturday. We've got a Patreon with Michael Bridges out. Hope everybody's enjoyed it. We'll keep trying.
We'll keep to get these fucking big stars on.
Big stars.
They are big stars, mate.
I know they are.
We'll see you next week. Bye, everyone.
Yeah, good night. God bless.
Under the cosh, under the cosh, it's under the cosh and friends. Oh, under the cosh, it's under the cosh, it's under the cosh and friends. Oh, week by week, we take a peek at another guest, but it's a mystery. Oh, Kylie Minogue, no, Russell Crowe, more likely a footballer that you don't know. So grab a beer and bring that cheer, cause it's time for Under the Cosh and Friends.
Really?
You're still live. Nah, I'm only joking.
We're still live.
I was only joking.
We're still alive, yeah. We're still alive. Are we still alive?
Yeah.
Where to begin? No, oh, I can't begin.